White Star. Perspective by Millie Chalk. When chatting with a friend from across the sea one rainy morning, the conversation turned, as it often does, to what we had accomplished for that day. We were both inside dealing with inclement weather, and by our own definition, had been less than what we considered to be productive. As usual, when we're together, we found ourselves thinking out loud and making lists of all the many things we'd been working on, and to our astonishment, it had been a very productive day for us both. So why had we thought ourselves lacking in the motivation department? What had made the difference in our perception of the value of our efforts? We milled the question around in our minds, throwing it back and forth among one another till we came upon the realization that the things we had worked to accomplish that day were things we really enjoyed and wanted to do in the form of creative pursuits. We could admit that some of our projects would pay monetary dividends while others would only do so in the future, if at all. Upon further reflection, we could not place a hard value on any of these projects when it came to making a living, but we were in agreement of their value nonetheless. That's when I asked the question of my friend, why is it that we only think of doing what we don't want to do as being productive? And why, if we're enjoying what it is that we are doing, do we refer to ourselves as being lazy or unmotivated and selfish? These questions brought me to suggest a new perspective. What if I told you that every time you did something creative, there was a payoff? What if you got paid to enjoy yourself? What if you got paid each time you laughed with a friend or took your dog out for a walk? What if you got a regular check in the mail for writing in your journal, listening to music or cooking a favorite meal, meditating or watching a series on TV that you really enjoyed and brought gladness to your heart? Which brings me to another question. What is the price of happiness? How much money does it cost? What's the price of health? Money can buy health care, but being healthy comes from within. What does that cost? I know many people, some close to me, that have extensive health care plans, yet suffer great pain and fatigue, limiting them physically. What have their health care dollars brought to them? Other than pills, the complication of the pills, and endless doctor's appointments along with trips to the pharmacy. So if money cannot buy you happiness or health, then what's it worth? If doing what you love buys you both happiness and health, how much is it worth to take a closer look at our lives and what we're doing with our time? Why does the almighty dollar have to be our only motivation and the standard to how we measure our success? Consider for a moment that happiness and health was our standard. How much different would we live our lives? It's true that money, or lack of, can push us to greater heights, but there is always a price to be paid. Are we willing to pay that price often in the form of disconnecting to who we really are? Perhaps we should ask, who are we really? Are we merely working machines, investing a lifetime of hard labor with the hopes that when we're old enough, we might finally be able to rest and begin to live? That is, if we're still healthy enough to enjoy our old age. I'm not saying it's a bad thing to work and earn money to support yourself and your family, be independent and responsible. But what I am saying is that we often put too little value on our creative and leisure time in the process. What if we start looking at such time spent in those pursuits as an investment in our well-being, and that we stop feeling guilty for indulging in the things that simply bring us joy? Each time we do something for ourselves, something that we can appreciate and causes us to feel gratitude, we should consider it a deposit in our health and happiness bank account. Doing things we've been raised to believe as being selfish could couldn't be further from the truth and instead is a demonstration of self-love. Any time you take a moment to watch a sunset, spend time with a pet, enjoy an artistic project, write a letter, muse over a Facebook post, take a vacation, or do anything that you, and maybe only you, can appreciate, you're filling that well of consideration for yourself that only you can do, not someone else. You must learn to love yourself first, for that love to radiate and grow to encompass those around you. Part of our problem is that the word love is thrown around way too much and can represent either end of the scale, from our feelings of generosity to possessiveness. But what gets us into trouble is our definition of the word as a thing. Consider the possibility that love is not a thing, but instead the word love represents an action. That would mean that self-love would be the action of showing ourselves the kind of love and generosity that we would have been taught is for everyone but ourselves. Can you imagine treating another with little or no regard the way many of us treat ourselves? If you were like me, you were always counseled to think of others before yourself, never asking anything for yourself in your prayers as if it would void out your request. I held this concept as a badge of honor for many disparaging years, living in hopelessness and despair. The bottom line is that no amount of time or sacrifice brought me the happiness I craved, because what I had not learned was that my happiness was an inside job. And while giving to others of my time, money, etc., brought me temporary joy, when it was all said and done, I was still alone and feeling undeserving of the blessings I had sought for so many. Once I had learned to love myself, and believe me, it's a lifetime process, I was able to more readily love another, no matter what or who they were or even how they treated me. When you love yourself, you no longer stand in judgment of another or their actions, because you no longer give them power over how you feel or the happiness you hold. Your happiness no longer depends on their behavior toward you or even their feelings about you. Is that not the definition of true freedom? So next time you tell yourself you're too busy to do something you enjoy or want to feel guilty for indulging in that thing that you really want, take a moment to look from a different perspective. Ask yourself, is this thing I want to do or have something I would gladly give to a loved one? If the answer is yes, then grab it before it gets away and rejoice in the appreciation that you have come to a place where you feel deserving, and continue to look for more of such opportunities to practice giving to yourself. Remember, until you truly love yourself, you have no love to give to another.